Good evening. The world is full of gems, and we are gathered here today in celebrating the memory of such rare Sri Lankan gem, who left behind an undying legacy. With that note, I would like to start the proceedings for the first memorial lecture of Dr. Upali Mahanama Memorial Foundation. Prior to commencing all proceedings, it is customary to play the national anthem, so I kindly request you to stand. Please remain standing. To start on an auspicious note, we will now have the lighting of the oil lamp. And to do the honors, may I please request the following dignitaries to come forward. Patron and Vice Patron of Dr. Upali Mahanama Memorial Foundation, Principal of Nalanda College, Past Principal of Nalanda College, Keynote Speaker of the evening, Mr. Bandula Warnapura, Chairman and committee members of the Dr. Upali Mahanama Memorial Foundation. Thank you all for doing your honors. You may return to your seats. When someone you love becomes a memory, that memory becomes a treasure. In remembrance of this eminent personality, I would like to invite his grandchildren and his great-grandchildren to come forward to pay floral tribute to the late Dr. Upali Mahanama. A hero is born among hundred. A wise man is found among thousands. But an accomplished one might not be found even among 100,000 men. Late Dr. Upali Mahanama was one such rare human being. Please join me in a moment of silence to reflect and pay respect to Dr. Upali Mahanama. Please stand. Thank you. Please take your seats.
Association and the president of the Association of Cricket. Sri Lanka, and later earned him a place in the executive committee of the board of government. Upali was a great engineer, a life of a party, a reticular and humorous.
Old man should never marry another woman because it's like one man buying a book for someone else to read.
Moreover, Upali discovered his innate talent as a professional marketer, starting with the Sri Lanka Insurance Corporation, moving on to Liverpool Institute Limited, where he was soon promoted for his exceptional performance.
I should know him as a pilot, and we've known each other for more than 60 years. Because we were colleagues at Liverpool Brothers, now known as the Liverpool. And both of us were a sales judge. And he was so unique in selling, whatever he was selling, he was selling, he was marketing. He excelled him. And he got promoted
to the simple business. But I took up his challenges. But he will never leave me alone. He will give you a difficult assignment. He will be there to guide you, to assist you, to make sure that the task that was given to me is accomplished. That was the man who Upali Mahanama. Having served as the national president of the JCC of Sri Lanka, he went on to become an international vice president, assigned to one of the from the strongest countries in the JCC world, namely Sweden, Denmark, Finland, Iceland, and Norway. Upali coming from the Indian subcontinent, it was not an easy task to serve in those countries where they had this feeling that they knew everything and there is nothing that is worth their future. But the body, the man he is, went there, did his job, and was able to accept. And even to this day, people talk about him. The body had so many accomplishments, whether it was in the agencies or even outside of this. And he was foundation that was given to me by working in the person of Upali could be more to that. I am ever so grateful to this man because if there's anyone who can help me, Upali was able to see the work of it, he was sent to Upali. For him, past, spirit, or religion didn't matter. He always was wanting to help individuals, especially young men. And I'm sure there are many individuals who will even now acknowledge and confess that they are what they are because they of some of the training that we got from the person who has within this room. And his father, his survivors, one of the JCs,
his unique skill and exposure to the JCs and his rapid rise to the top of his chosen profession earned him the reputation as a marketing guru and a consultant across a multitude of corporations and associations in Sri Lanka and across the region, conducting training seminars across Sri Lanka, Pakistan, Malaysia, India, Bangladesh, Australia and Singapore, as well as over 20 more countries across Europe, Africa and the Middle East. At the same time, he built and nurtured a new generation of marketers across Sri Lanka. He was a founding member of Sri Lanka Institute of Marketing. He was a visiting lecturer at the University of Colombo. He was appointed by the United Nations as a consulting trainer in 1998 to train UNHCR personnel in 70 countries. In 2005, Upali was conferred with a doctorate in business management by the Phoenix International University, USA, and a fellowship by the Society for Business Practitioners, UK. He also holds a membership of the New Zealand Institute of Management. Upali co-authored the book Marketing Skills in Management, published in India in 2008, and was conferred the prestigious English Sri Lanka Friendship Award by the Bharati Vidyapeeth University, New Delhi. It's not wrong to say that his mantra in life was service to humanity is the best way to die. He had many followers who would seek him out for assistance, be it kindly, personal, or even financial. He was one man who not only had time for anyone, but also the capacity to fit into the shoes and see beyond what anyone else could not see. He empowered hundreds, if not thousands, to provide opportunities, imparting knowledge, advising, and most of all, inspiring change. Upali was an active member of the Council of the United Freemasons of Sri Lanka.
Brother Upali was much loved, much respected, and a multi-talented Freemason who we were privileged to count as one of our members. He would uphold the principles of Freemasonry to the utmost. He not only preached Freemasonry, but also practiced the virtues of Freemasonry, of charity, the community, benevolence to the brethren, and brotherhood to its members. Charity, he did a lot of projects of the areas of Sri Lanka. He would give advice and guidance to brethren in their careers. If they were to face any danger, he would pre-warn them so that they set aside and avoid it or meet it well prepared. Brother Upali Mahanama was unanimously elected Worshipful Master of Lester Lodge in 1988. In recognition of the outstanding contribution he made, the Grand Lodge of Ireland, which is on its 300th year, also honored him with the honorary title of Honorary Past Grand Superintendent of Works in the year 1999. We, the brethren of Sri Lanka, sadly miss Brother Upali Sri Warnapura.
Today, the legacy of Dr. Upali Mahanama continues to shine through his children, Devakar and Tushar, his six grandchildren, and three great grandchildren. He was glad to be called a Mukta and proud to be the only one among his peers. It is the legacy of the man of many paths, each facet shining a bright light to the lives of people he has dedicated, guided, nurtured, and most importantly, empowered to become respectable Sri Lankans, no matter where I have been taken. Upali, a man for all seasons, a mentor, a great listener, a humble human being, he leaves a legacy in the hearts of those who were touched by him. Upali was a friend, companion, and a brother to all.
Chairman of the Foundation, Mr. Malik Carter. Patron of the Foundation, Mr. Lakshman Mahanama. Keynote speaker, Mr. Bandula Warnapura. To deliver the welcome address, I would like to invite Mr. Malik Carter, the chairman of Dr. Upali Mahanama Memorial Foundation, who is also the current chairman of JCI Senate Sri Lanka.
උසස් හැදියාව ගති ගුණ මහඟුකම මැණික් කැටය කීවොත් ඇති වරදකිම රටක් වටි නංවා ඇති වටින නම මිනිස් කමට ඔබගේ ගරු කරමි මම. On the second day of April 1983, at the then residence of the late Dr. Upali Mahanama, at 24.1 Hill Street, Dehiwala, one of Sri Lanka's greatest poets and writers, the late Karunaratna Abhesekara, his brother is here, I think Daya, penned these words in the visitor's book, which epitomizes the character and the nature of the man's life whom we are celebrating today. The last line, which speaks more about Dr. Mahanama, is worth a second reading. Minis kamata ubage, minis kamata ubage garu karami mama. The patron, members of the Upali Mahanama Foundation, members and relations of the Mahanama family, Nalandians, cricketers, brethren of the Masonic fraternity, JCs, invitees, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Dr. Upali Mahanama Foundation, let me extend a very warm welcome to all of you present today. Despite your busy schedule, to hear, beg your pardon, be present here as a mark of respect and honor to this great man. Some spoke to me personally and said that they were coming, and one of them said, no matter what work I might have, I will be there because Mr. Upali means a lot to me. He has helped me in different ways in my life, assisting me, advising me on complicated life matters. He is my motivator and has been with me throughout my problems and issues. Ladies and gentlemen, if you had a problem or an issue, maybe professional or personal, Dr. Upali will listen intently and virtually take over your problem and issues as his own problem and work towards solutions and acts very genuinely to resolve it like his own. He would go that extra mile for very deserving cases. There are distinct memories of the humanitarian which still resonates within me. Spending not days but months and years trying to rehabilitate a drug abuser, everyone else, including the family, gave up. I recall how we built two modest but fully furnished houses for two families displaced in the eastern province. They were chain cultivators. The breadwinners lost their lives because of the long ethnic problems we had in Sri Lanka at that moment of time. The two families, the wife and little children, were living under polythene shelter in the chainers. Dr. Mahanama got them two brand new houses, furnished them, and made sure that the children had enough money for schooling and living until their mature age. I recall how he was able to lead the people in a village, hundreds of them, to contribute in making a bridge with their labor to connect the village to the town. These are but a few examples of many activities he imitated, and charity was his hallmark. Upali never failed to impress anyone he encountered, irrespective of race, religion, caste, or creed. He understood and spoke a common language with everyone. A well-versed scholar on a myriad of subjects, he was able to contribute to any discussion, be it religion with a priest, international affairs with a diplomat, career prospects with a student, or impact of climate change with a farmer from far off land. The discussions were never far from being thought-provoking, humorous, and most unforgettable. He also leaves behind lasting impressions with whoever he meets. We're happy to have with us and privileged to have a minister, Arjuna Ranatunga, with us. Thank you very much for being here this evening to honor Dr. Upali Mahanama. The foundation would emulate and impress upon the life and vision of Dr. Mahanama for the better of mankind. We will stress on the value system he preached and will contribute towards positive change and help make this world a better place than it was founded. Thank you.
To introduce the keynote speaker of the evening, I would like to call upon Ms. Arunika Vikramasinghe, the Secretary of the Foundation and the Secretary of JCI Senate Sri Lanka. Our keynote speaker definitely deserves a place in history, for he was Sri Lanka's first test captain. He started playing top flight cricket in the 1975 World Cup. The finest moment of his illustrious career was in the 1979 World Cup, when he led Sri Lanka to a famous win against India. He later became a coach. He was director cricket operations for the Sri Lanka Cricket Board from 2001 to 2008. He joined the Asian Cricket Council as the development manager for Asia before moving to the ICC. Upali's and Bandula's lives were interrelated in so many ways. They were both students of Nalanda College, both played for the school, and then for their club, Bloomfield. They were both at Lever Brothers at one time. Both became members of the Colombo South Jaycees. In fact, it was Upali who introduced Bandula Warnapura to Jaycees. And the two were diehard cricket administrators in later years. Both were outspoken and vocal in issues they were passionate about. Bandula was an inspiration to the young Devaker and Roshan to enter professional cricket. In fact, Roshan entered the field of professional cricket when Bandula was captaining the Sri Lanka team. At the inaugural lecture of the foundation, we couldn't have found a better person than Bandula Warnapura as a keynote speaker to talk to us on a much loved subject, a subject very much close to both their hearts and minds, and of course, I think to all of us in today's context. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Bandula Warnapura.
Ayubowan to all of you. Arunika, thank you very much for the kind words. Swagna, Devaka and Roshan, and also Malik, thank you very much for inviting me, which is a privilege and honor to deliver this lecture as you have invited me to do. I thought it was going to be easy, but now what I find, which one was easier, facing the first ball in the first test match or making this lecture on Upali? I think this is much more tensed, but let's see how we manage. I met Upali in 1972 when I left Nalanda after playing the big match. I had to go and work as a casual clerk at Lever Brothers, arranged by Shelley Vikramasinghe. Because Shelley was working at Collett's and he had an idea of moving to Vellavatha Mills as general manager. So until such time that he moved to Vellavatha Mills, he wanted me to work as a casual clerk at Lever Brothers. That is where I met after a couple of days. Upali walked into my office, where I was seated on a little chair and a table, clueless of what's going on. And he came with his bouncy walk, as we all know, with a tie, head held high. I said, "Bandula, welcome to Levers." And he talked to the others and said, "Look here, this is Bandula from Nalanda. You know about him, he's a cricketer, and I want all of you to look after him." I mean, that made things easy for me at Levers, even though it was a very short period of time, 6 months only, then I moved to Vellavatha Mills. Then I met him again at Bloomfield, as we all know. He was playing for the Division 3 team, and he was very close to Shelley, and we used to practice together, and he used to captain the Division 3 side, which you all know about. Then he took me to JC's, as Avanika said. I became a Vellavatha JC, which I didn't know anything about, but ultimately I found out it was quite interesting. We were meeting different kind of people, and Upali was behind us all the time. And that's how I became a JC, but didn't stay there much. A couple of years after, I had to give up because I was very much involved in the game of cricket and didn't have time. And we were going on like this, and suddenly, when I was captain in Bloomfield, Roshan came for Bloomfield practices. He had some difficulties at Nalanda, and he was reluctant to go for practice at Nalanda. So since Upali was a Bloomfielder and we were there, and we had a policy at that time in Bloomfield, for every match that we play, one senior player got to step down to allow a junior to play in the team. So therefore what we did was we took turns. So when Roshan came in as a youngster of 14 years plus, good fielder, very punctual at practices, I think that would have come from Mr. Nelson Mendes. We thought that we must give this boy a chance, and we gave a match for him to play. That is how Roshan played at 14 years, played for Bloomfield, Division 1 side. Then I met Upali again. He was not a doctor then, so I'm calling Upali. When he was the president of the Umpires Association, and there was a lot of accusations saying that the umpires are not giving out to Roshan because his father was the president of the Umpires Association. Especially no LBWs were given. That's what they say, that's why Roshan is scoring runs. Typical, I mean, every these kind of talk goes on. If you have somebody somewhere, they always say, "Look here, because your father is here, your uncle is there, you know, you're getting things done." So I asked Upali, what is this talk about, you know, the umpires? Bandula, I came to help the umpires. I came to help them, nothing else. They're talking about Roshan being not given LBW. I said, "Is that the only way they can get my son out? Is that the only way, LBW only? There are so many other ways. Why can't they get him out in that way?" I said, "Don't take seriously, Bandula. These things do take place in this world." That's Upali. He never worried about Mahanama, Roshan, because they knew that Roshan was going to make it. He never, when he wanted to do something, help somebody, he did that. And he was not bothered about the loose talk. Again, when he was the president of MCA, we have been to South Africa. And there was a 25-year ban imposed on us. And all the members who were affiliated to the board, they've asked them to fall in line with that ban of 25 years, saying that it's a Gleneagles agreement, so therefore you have to fall in line with the decision taken by the board. I heard that Upali at the MCA has not fallen in line. He has refused to implement that ban on us and accept that ban. I went and asked Upali, Upali, what have you done? Why do you do that? Well, your son is playing under 19 cricket. He's going to have a lot of problems if you don't do it. The answer he gave me was, Bandula, Gleneagles agreement says you cannot trade with South Africa. The mercantile sector, in the mercantile listing, most of our customers, members are trading with South Africa. So Gleneagles agreement, if they put forward, it's double standards. You can't do that. But we are trading with them. Therefore, then we must stop trading with South Africa. Then I will implement that 25-year ban. Roshan had a lot of problems because of that. Upali had a lot of problems. Because even at those days, you know, there were people who were running the show on their own. I'm talking about the Bodakan cricket in Sri Lanka. And there were strong people. There were people who were running the whole show. And they were very strong. And I'm sure Roshan and Upali got some works with them, with that guy, that person. So that is how Upali worked. Because when he believed on something, when he knew that it is not fair, he always stood up and didn't agree with others who want to do things. So that is Upali. Upali also played cricket for Nalanda. I do not know whether anybody who played with Upali are here. I'm sure there must be. But I must tell you, Upali was a terrible, popular guy at Nalanda. That's what I heard. We saw on the presentation what he had done for Nalanda during Nalanda time. But I must tell you one thing which I heard recently. He was a good big brother. At the end of this event today, we will have a little function, I think, a tea party or something like that. But then just make sure that you talk to Palitha Pera, the famous commentator. You ask Palitha how Upali used to hold his hand, bring him to Nalanda, and again after school how he took him back and gave him to the parents. Palitha is here. Palitha? Yes, Palitha is here. So that is Upali. And that is Upali that we all knew. But further, to remain as a hero, as a father, as a grandfather, until you die, is very difficult to maintain. To be a hero, to continue to be a hero, only a good father can do that. To be a hero to your wife, only a good husband can do that. We all know, even last night when I met Roshan, the way he was telling me about the way that Upali used to advise him as a father, and how we respect his father even now, shows the unique quality of Upali to be a hero right throughout your life, to your family, to your sons, your kids, your grandkids, and to your wife. So that's why we are gathered here today, all of you, to make sure that we do that, give that respect to Upali. Upali was our hero as well. Whenever you go for a function, the way he start entertaining, making everybody easy, is what Upali did. We all know that, how he used to sing, how he used to talk, how he used to get all of us to relax. And then we all respect Upali for that. And he is our hero even now. We are going to miss him. We will miss him. With that, I come into my subject points given. Sri Lanka cricket, past, present and future. Few minutes before I walked into this place, I met some other cricketers. He said, Bandula, yeah, you had to cut down your speech by one third. I asked, what? You can talk about the past, You can talk about the present, but can you talk about the future? Is there going to be a future? Yes, there will be a future. There is going to be a future. We talk about the present. It's much easier because we have a lot of information, a lot of news going floating all over. We have lost badly. There is no board. There are no board officials. There are only two people who are running the whole show. There are match fixing, spot fixing. You name it, we have it. We have hit the rock bottom of all of this now. We have hit the rock bottom. I believe in that. We have hit the rock bottom. But only good thing is, whatever we do now, whatever we have to do now, if we don't do it, and if we do it now, we can only go up. We cannot go below this. When the under-19 team played against in the under-19 Asia Cup 2-3 days ago, we are happy that they came to the finals. And we saw some talent in that. So there is a light, there is that amount of hope that we can. So there is a future. So don't give up. Criticize now, but don't forget it is Sri Lanka cricket that we all want to develop. People who played before, the players who played before us, people like Michael Tisagas, K.L. Gamuas, Sahabandus, Satasiums, all that, they played and they brought the game for us to play. We played when Arjuna, Roshan and the whole lot took over. They left, this person has taken over. Our appeal to them, we plead to them, don't kill this game. Don't destroy this game. Keep playing so that the future youngsters will have cricket to play in this country. That's how I see it. With that, let's go to the past and see what has happened. I think most of you are aware of what happened. I started playing in 1973 for the Sri Lanka team and played in the 1975 World Cup and 1979 World Cup. We played in the first World Cup because we were straight away asked to play in the World Cup. But 79 we had to qualify to play in the World Cup with the other associate countries. The 1979, when I came, there were, as I said earlier, there were groups, there were individuals who were running the whole show, who had, you know, everything on their own. They used to dictate terms, they used to decide what to do, whom to come in. In fact, they used to decide whom to become at the, you know, who should come as president. And you can see that happened after 1979. They wanted me to arrange a meeting with them, with that group, to meet Shelly Vikramasinghe to become the president. So since I was Bloomfield, Shelly was with us, I arranged that meeting, but Shelly never became the president of the board. Why? Because I don't think he agreed to the conditions laid down by that group of people. And he never became the president. For 18 years, the border control, Robert Chennaiah was the president of the border control for 18 years. Nobody contested, nobody came forward. Reason was, there was no money. Robert Chennaiah, whenever board wanted money, he gave the money. So there was no contest at all for 18 years. Then the whole thing changed. When we started playing in the 1979 World Cup, money started coming in. And you find later on, we are having fights, we are having groups now trying to come in at the position of the border control. That is the trend. That happened. Group A joins Group C to beat the Group B or the person B. Next year, the Group B joins Group A to throw out the oopsie guy. I mean, this is how it's going on. It has gone on like that. It's going on now. It's going on now. Somebody got to do something. Who's going to do that? If you don't do things, these things now, we don't settle these things, if you don't put things right, we are going to suffer. Cricket is going to suffer in this country, and the future is going to be bleak. Where the ministers of sports, which we saw recently, past ministers joining hands with the ex-president, attacking another past captain. When they were ministers, why could not they do the right thing that had to be done? The whole problem is most of the ministers appointed, in Sinhala it says, Vassatava Dupunati Kattiyatama appointment. So, we cannot expect them to do the right thing sometimes, most of the time, for the game of, for the sports. The two ministers which comes to my mind, Sugat Dasa, I do not know, Mr. Sugat Dasa, he was before me, but K.B. Ratnayaka, who did so much for cricket, he was a sportsman. Then we have Vincent Perra, who did so much for football. Any other, I cannot think of any other person, any other minister doing anything worthwhile to keep the sports going in this country. We hope the present minister of sports, whether acting or not acting, will do something to put all these things right. What are we talking about? What are the things that we must put right? We start from the Constitution. 140 votes in the Constitution. 140 votes in the Constitution. Do you need that? I personally believe we don't need that. That's a power base. Anybody can. Today what they do is they use the border control money, distribute among the districts, provinces and other areas, and they gain power. I think not only me, so many cricketers up to now have said, look here, you have to change the Constitution. Yes, you have to change the Constitution. How many do we need? Maybe 20, 25, 30, but somebody got to sit down, work out the details and decide exactly how much you need. I'm not going to go into detail because I have studied a little bit, but if I go into those details, I don't think it's going to be interesting. But what we say, we have to cut down the number of votes. Got to do that. Who can do that? How you can do that? I'm not a lawyer. But somebody got to sit down and see exactly and take action on this. Then comes the sports law of this country. Number two, it is not affecting us, but it is in the ICC, it says there should not be any political interference in the cricket board, governing body. Now when you have the sports law in Sri Lanka, where the selectors are appointed to the board by the Minister of Sports, recommendations given by the cricket board, but selectors are appointed by the minister. The team which is selected by the selectors who are appointed by the minister has to be given back to the minister for approval. But minister, I said earlier, Vassatava Duela Rahe. So if there is a problem in selections, minister is also responsible. Now, about a week ago, suddenly I started getting calls saying that, Bandula, have you been appointed as chairman of selection committee? I said, news to me. Nobody has even spoken to me. No. They said you are going to be the chairman of selection committee. I said, I cannot, because this was offered to me about 6-7 months ago. But I categorically said, look, I cannot bear the conflict, because my son is in the pool, cricket pool. So I cannot be a selector. If I don't select him, I can't stay at home. If I select him, I can't stay in the country. So why take over that headache? So I said, on that I can't. But you give me something else, I'll do. You give me something where we can work cleanly, without interference, with a free hand. We will work. People see that, look here, what are you guys doing? Excavators, what are you doing? You work for ACC, you work for ICC. Why don't you do something for Sri Lanka cricket? I nearly did. 4 years ago, I was offered the CEO's post. Came all the way from Malaysia for a discussion. There were five in the interview board or the discussion. President, secretary, assistant secretary, vice president, treasurer. We had a wonderful discussion. I thought of having only 2 years. They said, no, Bandula, we'll give you 3 years. Next day morning, all what we discussed, term, condition, everything, appeared in the internet. Next day morning. Then ACC got excited, Bandula, have you given a word to join Sri Lanka? I said, no, it was only a discussion. So the leak was done by one of those five people. And one thing I said in that was, if I'm the CEO, I'm the CEO. Nobody will represent me in international meetings. People used to go because you get a free ticket, you know, everything is given free, and you also you get a $300 allowance per day. So I said, if I'm the CEO, I'm the CEO, nobody will go instead of me. If I can't go, I'll recommend somebody else to go. Then they wanted me to train three people to take over after 3 years. I said, okay. And the three names which they came forward, I totally cancelled them. I said, look here, no point. So this is how it worked. And ultimately what happened, 3 days later I hear a message coming in, minister has not approved you because you're too old. So I said, fair enough. Then why do you call me for all the way from Malaysia to come over here? Then I join ACC, they give me a 3 year contract. For ICC I'm not old, but for SLC I was old. So this is how they want the past cricketers to come and work. Allow us a free hand, let us do the right thing. We will work as a group and we will do whatever we have to do for this game of cricket. But create that atmosphere. That's very important. I talked about the constitution, I spoke about the sports law. I will touch on the domestic tournaments in Sri Lanka. Is there any quality in those tournaments? There is no quality. There are 20 odd teams playing. How can there be quality? During our time when we played in the past, we had only about 10 or 11 or 12. We used to play home and away. They don't reduce the teams because their own catchers are having clubs and therefore they cannot reduce. They are not worried about the quality of the tournament. If you don't play quality tournaments, if you don't create the same pressure situations in the domestic tournament, same pressure as when you play international cricket, our boys will never get used to that kind of tackling those issues. We have to create that at domestic level tournaments so that they can, whenever there's a pressure situation in the international level, that they will know how to face it. So don't blame the boys for losing all these things. We have not created that kind of a situation, quality tournaments, pressure areas for our players to be trained, face. Bring it down to 10. Another reason why they can't bring it down, because all 24 clubs are playing and they are given first class status. To play in league cricket in England and other countries, a player got to play 8 matches of first class cricket in their own country. So the job agents who are running the clubs, they make sure that they maintain the first class status for 20 clubs. when we had the tier 1 and tier 2 sometime back, 10 teams and 10 teams we had, but all 20 teams were given first class status because you have to play that 8 matches to go and play in other countries. So the 10 teams who are in tier B, only way they could keep the top players is because they get that 8 matches of playing first class cricket. Is it what we need? Is that what we need for Sri Lanka cricket? Is that what we need to get good cricketers to come out? No, that is not what we need. Quality tournaments. Quality tournaments. So these are things that we got to think of again. We are talking about not having captains. We are short of captains. We have under 19 national team. We play under 23 tournament. We have clubs. We have provincial tournaments. We have an A team. Can't we develop captains? Where are the captains of those teams? So what are we doing? Are we doing the right thing? We cannot be short of captains. But there is another problem coming in. You go back to, I'll come to later about the school cricket. At school cricket level, the coaches are not allowing the school boys to take decisions on the field. Everything is done by the coach, including field setting and bowling changes. We don't allow the boys to take decisions on the field. Are we building captains? Are we building leaders? No, we are not. It must start from the school level. Whose responsibility? It's Sri Lanka cricket to go do that. I hear now that the education department is trying to have a separate that from the SLC and run it on their own. I don't know whether it's the right thing or the wrong thing, but if it is the right thing, good luck. But if it is not right, don't do it. It's very bad. We have a Minister of Sports and Minister of Education. We have a school cricket structure, best in the world many years ago, but I do not know whether it's best in the world now. But yes, we have a structure. But is it the right structure? No, I don't think so. Are we producing cricketers, national cricketers in the schools, or are we playing to win matches and tournaments? If any school provides, develop a cricketer to play for Sri Lanka, that is what you need. Everybody will be happy. That's the target. You are talking about outstation schools. Outstation schools today are feeders to Columbus schools, except for a few schools. If you go through the under 19 tournaments and matches, there are few schools who are producing good cricketers under 19. One is Richmond College, Gaul. If they are producing sufficient enough or may lot of under 19 cricketers for the national under 19 team, somebody got to study as to how they are doing it. Learn from them what they are doing and implement that to other schools, or get them to do the same thing in other schools. Otherwise what's happening is outstation, all the boys when they play for under 15, all the good boys are absorbed and recruited by the Colombo schools. That happens. If a cricketer is developed, we say a boy from Ambalanguda, like Chandimal, played for Ambalanguda, he joins Ananda College, he's captain Sri Lanka. Now he's an established player in the national squad. Why can't the border control give an incentive for producing that boy, a national player, to that school? Maybe a couple of millions to develop cricket in that school. If he has played under 15 up, you know, in another school, we say Chandimal, Ananda, Pamananda, he played national team, but then under 15 up to under 15 he played Ambalanguda Dharmasoka. Divide that amount that they are giving to give and give it to these two schools. The amount of money that we are spending unnecessarily, do it that way. So what will happen is all outstation schools hereafter will be more than happy to send their cricketers to a Colombo school when they are played under 15. Why? They get a grant, they get funds to develop their game of cricket in that school. So these are things that we got to look into and do that part. So that's why I said we are willing to do things. Yes, we will do, but make the atmosphere right for us to come. Saying that, I'm taking it to another aspect. Talk about the education ministry and the border control. You know the fifth year scholarship, in my thinking, it's killing sport in this country. The year five scholarship, all parents in outstation or most of them in Colombo, for about 2-3 years, they won't allow their children to take part in sports. They don't allow their children, they want them to study maths, Sinhalese. Keep on studying, don't go for this thing, don't do that, don't do, keep on studying. For 2-3 years, they push on doing that. I can imagine an outstation school doing that because they want to join a Colombo school. But little bit we know, we call it in sports, the eye-hand coordination. The eye-hand coordination is what you see from your eyes. The message got to go to your system, to your brain and all that, and then you start getting that. If you don't practice that, what do we get? Or in sport we say in a healthy body for a healthy mind. But are we doing that at that level? No, we are not doing that. So ultimately what we are having after doing the year 5 examination, we get children who doesn't have that required amount of eye-hand coordination. That's why you find sometimes in the parliament people can't even clap to a rhythm. Because if you don't develop that at school level, at young level, you mean to say that can we develop that at when they are at year 6? No, we can't do that. As parents, as you know, sportsmen, we all know that how important the eye-hand coordination is. You got to walk properly, you got to run properly, they got a rhythm in everything that you got to do. If you don't get that rhythm in your life, anything, everything that you do, there's a rhythm. But we are killing it. Then we have another problem. At university entrance, they give marks for sports and other activities, they give marks at university level. Now, we enter the university, you are given that extra marks. Where is sports in our universities today? What's the level of sports in universities? I'm sad to say, they have the best facilities. Kandy, Peradeniya, you see amount of facilities they have. You go to Colombo, they have the best facilities, but then do they, what? Why the sports in universities now? My this thing is, in my belief, that in year 5, when you do the exam in year 5, give them about 10 to 15 marks or maybe a little bit more or whatever for the sports and other activities that you carry out which are accepted by the education ministry. Give them that amount of marks so that the parents will never stop them from taking part in them while they are sitting for the exam. Same thing with O level. Now we know in cricket, when you are doing O level at under 17, they give up cricket for about 2-3 years because of the exam. But if you give that extra marks for a boy who has been in the under 17 team at particular school, regular player, you give that extra mark, they will never stop. Parents will never stop them from taking up those sports. Do the same thing at A level. Why do at university entrance? No, do that at A level, do that at O level, do it at year 5. Then you will feel that the boys will have the coordination, they have a rhythm, they can dance, they can clap, and do whatever they have to do which is required at that level. So that is how we see how we can develop this sports, especially the game of cricket. Yeah, now we talk about the game of cricket. So we can do that if you put all these things right. What we are talking about, the exams, we said extra marks for sports and other activities, accepted activities. We talked about the club cricket tournament being quality, rearrange the whole thing. Then we talk about the constitution of the border control. So if we had to put those things right, and we talk about KB Ratnayaka and talk about Vincent Pereira. So looking at the whole thing, the present Minister of Sports can be a KB Ratnayaka, can be a Vincent Pereira or Sugata Dasa in the history of this country of sports. Change the constitution, reduce the votes, prepare a proper constitution, change the sports law, change the local tournament structure, change all those things. Not only the Minister of Sports, I think got to join. The President of this country and the Prime Minister also got to join hands and do this. Then only we will see it right. We will start now, then we will be okay another 4-5 years' time. If you don't start it now, as somebody told me when I walked in, there's no future for cricket. There's no future. So with that, I think the Upali's theory of amount of contribution he had made to the country, amount of contribution that he made to all of us, helped us, the legacy that he left, the hero he is, we also can be something like that. I know how many of us can be proud if you say we have even done 50%, 25% or 10% of what Upali had done to all our friends, to the society. And if we can be happy that we have done something at the end, I think we'll be happy and we can go home saying that, yes, thank you, Upali, for giving all that. I don't know whether I have taken time. There are no questions and answers, which is a good thing. But then, as I said earlier, don't forget, the past cricketers are ready to come forward. We are not forgotten, we are watching. They are talking about today the match fixing and spot fixing. Match fixing got to be done by the captain with about another 3 or 4 seniors. Spot fixing can be done by individuals. It can be done by the captain and one other individual. So these are things we are talking about. And the problem that we are facing today, the story that we are hearing today, that all can be stopped. What I believe, if a player comes to the national team under contract, if an employee comes to the border control, if an office bearer comes to the border control, get them to sign a document saying that he is not involved in this declaration. Get that declaration signed and put it in the file. Well, later on, if you find that he's involved, it's double the fault that he had done, because he's declared that he's not involved, but he had done it. So punishment can be much more severe. If you have a little information that somebody had done that, banned for life. You saw what Imran Khan has said recently, a few days ago. If anybody is involved in match fixing or spot fixing, we'll ban him for life. If you have done that in the past, if you have taken serious action in the past, this wouldn't have come out. The tour that we went in 1994, I was the coach. I was the coach. But I hear in the news now, the ex-president, the past sports minister talking about this was done, there was inquiry held, that was cleared and all that kind of thing. But one thing I must tell you, I went as the coach on that tour. Up to now, nobody has asked me or questioned me on that tour. So if there was an inquiry, I'm sad that these things have not taken place. If there was something wrong, if I taken action then, or whenever the issue has come out, today these things won't happen. So far, nobody has been punished. So therefore, action got to be taken, firm decision got to be taken, and only then only we can talk about the future. Future is there. Our school cricket is still good, but we got to work hard. With that, gentlemen, I wish you all the best. Thank you very much for listening, and I hope I have covered enough. Thank you very much.
Sir, thank you very much for your timely and thought-provoking message. May I now invite our patron of the foundation, Mr. Lakshman Mahanama, to present a memento to Mr. Bandula Warnapura. As all good things must come to an end, I would like to invite Mr. Roshan Mahanama, Vice Patron of the Foundation, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Let me begin with this phrase as a tribute to my father. I'm at ease at the crease than saying my piece on occasions like these. My father was my idol, hero, role model, a man I looked up to and tried to emulate. Years ago, when I voiced my reluctance to deliver speeches, my father, in his typical no-nonsense style, pointed out that this was an obligation I could not refuse. Reminiscent of the many times he has stepped in to ease my worries, he suggested I begin all my speeches with the simple phrase which I just mentioned. Honorable Minister, my former Captain Arjuna Ranathunga, members of the cricketing fraternity, representatives of the media, well-wishers, family and friends. As we reflect on the life of Upali Mahanama, I'm certain that such simple yet profound moments are etched in the minds and hearts of many of those who came into contact with him. His ideals and strong moral compass guided us to make the right decisions, even during difficult times. How does one pay tribute to someone who was larger than life, but also a friend, a colleague, a mentor, and most of all, a loving father? The establishment of the Dr. Upali Mahanama Memorial Foundation is a way of keeping his memory alive by promoting in a meaningful manner the values he stood for: integrity, dignity, loyalty, and honesty. As we conclude this inaugural keynote address, no words are adequate enough to thank our keynote speaker, Mr. Bandula Warnapura. But let me try anyway. Bandulaya, thank you very much for accepting our invitation to deliver the keynote address today. As a fellow Nalandian and a great admirer of your cricketing feats as a youngster, I know my father would be glad that you accepted our invitation. I'm sure your words of wisdom were well received by all who are present here today. Organizing an event of this magnitude is not an easy task. Only a person of the caliber of Malik Kader could do it within a span of a few months. Malik, you have steered the foundation to realize its goals in what feels like lightning speed. As a witness to the close friendship you enjoyed with my father over the years, I'm ever thankful to you for initiating the setting up of this foundation. As the work of the foundation takes off, my sincere hope is that you continue to maintain your formidable presence and help us to make things happen. My thanks to the ever energetic Arunika for the consistency and paying detailed attention as the secretary to coordinate the affairs of the association and this event. Lucky Bappa, Uncle Rohan, Uncle Setu Kavala, Uncle Carlisle, and Natalie, thank you for adding strength to the foundation. A warm thank you to the members of the media present here today, the official print media partner Vijay Newspapers Group, and in particular, Ram and Sujit, for coordinating with the media on our behalf, the editors of the Daily Mirror, Sunday Times, and the Financial Times. Thank you. Rupo Aini Corporation and other TV channels, and in particular, batsman.com, thank you for graciously offering to cover the event. Let me also take this opportunity to extend our thanks to a number of very special people, Buddhini and Harindu. Thank you for offering a memorable take on my father's life through the video. And thank you, Uncle Iswani, Uncle Setu Kavala, and Uncle Robin for helping us. To everyone else who has extended support to us in various ways, though we may not be able to thank you individually, your efforts are much appreciated. To my family and the numerous friends my father gathered around him in his walk of life, thank you for coming together to remember and celebrate Tata's life. I take your presence today as a reflection of a life well lived and a symbol of the lasting impression he has left in your lives. To every member of this esteemed audience, thank you for joining us to reflect on what has been and what is yet to be in Sri Lanka cricket. As a cricket-loving nation, we hope the sports track record of bringing people together will continue to hold in spite of the rough terrain ahead. Last but not least, let me acknowledge the silent sentinels of the foundation. To the Senate and members of the Junior Chamber International and the Freemasons of Sri Lanka, we extend our heartfelt gratitude for joining hands with us in establishing this foundation. JCs, your decision to pay tribute to one of your founder members by helping us to establish this foundation is highly appreciated. I sincerely hope this relationship will flourish in the years to come. Before you start nodding off, let me bring the memorial keynote address to a close by making a humble appeal. I intend working closely with the JCs to launch a campaign through the schools targeting the teachers and the students after O levels. The objective is to reach out to these youngsters who, in essence, are future and drive home the values that my father strongly believed we should all embrace in our lives. That is not to allow values, honesty, integrity, loyalty and discipline, and above all friendship, be overshadowed by the temptation of money. By imparting such values to the next generation, we will carry the torch that my father lit so many years ago. Let this endeavor be an auspicious beginning to many more. Whilst I thank you for being a part of this memorial lecture, I wish to leave behind a thought. Former American President John F. Kennedy made a profound statement when he said, "Ask not what the country can do for you, but what you can do for the country."
With that, we conclude the first program of the Dr. Upali Mahanama Memorial Foundation. On behalf of the foundation, I invite you to join for refreshments at the garden. Thank you. It was a pleasure having you here. Good evening.